the music, please. Music, please. Hello, music? Who's that? Who's that? Listen. And there goes the music. Thank you for coming. Welcome to the Blue Macaw. Give yourselves a round of applause. You made it. We're here. You can move up. You don't have to like be so far back in the space. Eugene Robinson cannot be here tonight. He apparently took a paying gig instead. So if he wants to sell out and be a commercial fuck face, that's fine. No, we don't need him, really.
Does that mean he's not an iconoclast anymore?
He's not an iconoclast.
That's right.
He's just another whore writing for money. Fuck that. Okay. My name's Jack Boulware. I'm a co-founder of Litquake. We have a very cool event coming tonight. Just right here. These are people that I think are very cool in the Bay Area. And even though they don't all produce books every single year, I think it's very important that they're on a stage at Litquake because they help make the city what it is. And so there you have it, Bay Area Icon Class. The first author that we're going to have read tonight, I've known her for a very long time. She was doing this lesbian erotica magazine called On Our Backs. Does anybody remember that? Yes. In the 1980s? Fun, raunchy. I actually interviewed her for another magazine, and my magazine got banned from Safeway for eternity because of Susie Bright. I don't know. Who needs Safeway anyway? Their produce sucks. Susie's gone on to do so many great things. She's been in movies. She's written tons of books. She's put together so many anthologies. She has an insanely intelligent blog that all of you should read if you don't already. And she lives in Santa Cruz, and she came up here last night in an evening gown, thinking the show was last night, and then had to drive back to Santa Cruz. So she's not wearing an evening gown tonight. But she is here, so please welcome Susie Bright.
Thanks, Jack. I'll come up with the evening gown next time. I want to read you something I just finished. It's a chapter from my first memoir. It's called Big Sex, Little Death. And this chapter is called... Comp Camp. Is this dry ice that I found myself?
It's Halloween. No.
Opium smoke.
Fog. It's fog.
It's the effect.
It's going to get worse.
Oh, great. I am a witch, but really. Okay. I'm being obscured by your dry ice. Where did that come from?
This
man. This takes place in Detroit in 1976. I was 17. Chili liked to say that his Ford Econoline was infallible. I loved him, but Chili liked to say everything was the opposite of what it really was. That was his humor. He coaxed his baby all the way out to Detroit from Oakland, and he had the empty Pennzoil cans to prove it. When Temma told me we were getting a ride back to town from Chili in his infallible Ford van, she didn't understand why I sunk my head in my camp pillow. We were 60 miles outside of Detroit, and I was looking forward to heading home after a week of old-school Bolshevik history lessons, sing-alongs, labor organizing tips. I'd been cooking for 200-plus every night, and it'd been a blast, but I wanted to fall into my couch at home and go to sleep for a week. "What's your problem?" Temma said, swatting my bottom. "Chili's leaving camp tomorrow. It's perfect. It's only an hour and a half away." She tucked her long hair behind her ears with their enormous gold hoops. "Can't you get one of your Cadillac friends to chauffeur us?" I asked. Tama screwed up her heart-shaped face. "That's over," she said, and then sang, "It was just one of those things, but it's all over now," switching lyrics and going flat. "And we have a very nice ride with Chili if you and Hank Running Horse can keep your fists off each other." Running Horse was Chili's best friend from high school. They did everything together. Running Mouth, as he was often called to his face, was as obnoxious as Chili was kind. But they had built an Oakland chapter of the Red Tide up from nothing, and I had to hand them that. "Is anyone else coming?" I asked, resigning myself. "Maybe Joe, maybe Steve P, I don't know, but you have a seat." 4 hours later, Chili found me in the kitchen, stripping the clean dishes out of the Hobart. "Sue, I'm sorry, the Ford is screwed. The transmission only goes in reverse, and that's with a lot of bleeding." I looked around the camp kitchen. We were the only two left. "There's hardly anyone here," I said. "Who's gonna take us back to the city?" Chili said he'd already thought of that. He was a little too enthusiastic, or maybe he was just playing his opposite's game. He told me that some auto worker contact named Earl also had a Ford Econoline, and he was gonna take Frank, Steve P, and me all the way back to the office, door-to-door service. "He lives in Hamtramck," he added, like that was a plus. Yeah, I'm glad you know. Someone here better know where Hamtramck is. A new contact up here? I was a little startled. The whole point of commie camp was to better educate yourself so you could be a better recruiter. But you have to be pretty deep into socialism to attend in the first place. It wasn't for newcomers. I'd heard more obscure Trotskyite history in the past week than I'd hear again in a lifetime. Last night, Fat Henry had gotten drunk, peeled off his undershirt so all his fur stuck out, and started bellowing out some dirty ballad about a trot named Max Shackman and a fat girl. Really, I had been in the International Socialist for a year and a half now, and I was the closest to a newbie I'd met at this camp. "This guy's Earl's been mostly studying with the UAW caucus in the East Barracks," Chili said, pointing behind him. I shrugged and said I'd be ready in an hour. Like young scout in To Kill a Mockingbird, if I could have taken Chili's hand right then, and with great prescience, I would have said, "And there started the longest night of our lives." I wasn't happy to be the only girl in the car. Tim had disappeared into the night with some new beau from the River Rouge plant who wore a silver spoon around his neck and had a Cadillac just for two. When we gathered at the parking lot at noon, I started to get in the back of the van, not looking at anyone, ready to read my John Reed memoirs in the back seat. Running Horse grabbed my forearm and said, "No, Sue, you sit up front." It was impossible to think that Frank was being chivalrous. The best seat in the vehicle? What gives? Frank rejected all niceties of male-female etiquette as counter-feminist, and everyone who knew him understood he let a door slam on his grandmother's puss without a second glance. I climbed up into the bucket seat, still puzzled, and came face-to-face with Mr. Earl's big yellow grin and even yellower hair hopped up in the driver's seat. "Hey there, jailbait!" the goober cried out. "I'm Earl Van Nuys III. God almighty, don't rock the ammunition, darling." He reached down into the console between us and came up with an open bottle. He threw his head back and gargled it down, which was saying something considering the low headroom. I turned back to the boys in the back seat to accuse somebody of something, but it was too late. They all looked at me with beseeching eyes, communicating one single thought: humor him. Well, Running Horse's eyes weren't beseeching, they were more like, "Maintain, bitch." Earl finished his gargle and fired the ignition in a smooth stroke for someone who'd obviously been high for the past several days. He was so gracefully plastered that when his other hand fired up a joint, I realized he was backing up the van with his knees. I checked my seatbelt. Earl was a NAM vet, two tours, baby, but they must have gone on forever because Earl would not shut up about it. He craved our audience, my ears in particular. I had to share his smoke and brimstone. He was a veteran of the U.S. fucking army, and they had fucked him. But who was they? I mean, he was an IS contact, right? He must be in the army, or at the very least, the VA hospital. But within the first 15 minutes, he was saying fucking Charlie and fucking Duke about a dozen times. There wasn't enough soap in the world to wash his mouth out. I was cringing, and I cheated a glance at Running Horse, who silently shook his head from side to side. Don't do it. Don't say it. Shut up. Steve B looked like a skinny rabbit, his eyes getting pinker and pinker, his forehead a mass of sweating acne. Chili's eyes held my sympathy, and I tried to imagine his meaning. This, too, shall pass. Earl acted like the boys weren't there. He didn't pass the joint to them, I did. My heart was beating loud enough to hear it in my head, and I couldn't stop staring at the bottle Earl kept between his knees. It must be nearly empty by now. He might as well have hung a sheet on the side panel, "Welcome Highway Patrol to open container drinking." If we got stopped, the shock of the booze and the pot would soon give way to a full FBI investigation as to what was in our backpacks and boxes. We had a full load of incriminating evidence, socialist books, rifles, mailing lists. Unbelievable. Earl reached behind his seat and pulled out another fifth. I swore under my breath. Hank moved forward from the bench seat. He grabbed Earl's shoulder. "Hey, man," he said, "take it easy. We've got to get the youngster home in one piece." "Hey, man," Earl cackled and shook him off. "I don't take it easy, man. I take it." He whooped like a lunatic version of some wobbly song he picked up at camp. The van swerved, but there was no one in the next lane. Something long and silver flashed out from beneath my seat when Earl corrected the wheel, and I yelped, "What's this?" It was something in a holster. I picked it up. Earl shouted again and temporarily forgot to unscrew his next bottle. "Open it up, darling, and see what's inside," he urged me. "That's my lady." I heard Steve P. whimper, and Chili and Hank moved forward. I was glad for a distraction from the whiskey. It was a knife. No one would have known what it was at first glance, though, because it looked like a medieval instrument. Earl snatched it from my hand and said, "Isn't she beautiful? My lady gutted Charlie many times. Oh, yes, she did." I thought I was going to throw up. The blade was a foot long, one side curved like a pirate's sword, the other side serrated like a saw. The tip formed a hook. I could see why Earl talked about her like she was a person, a she-warrior, a terrorist who could slay all the butter knives and steak cutters in a dishpan army. Earl liked to talk with his knife in his hand. He gestured and gesticulated through 100 more soldier stories. My eyes stayed on the western light playing on his blade. Running Horse tried to interrupt, of course, wanted to doubt him. Hank had never handled such a knife, and I could tell he wanted to. But Earl wasn't going to let go of it now. I could feel Chili drawing closer to Hank, tempering him quietly, so familiar. If he could soothe Running Mouth, and I could calm Earl, and Steve P. could stop mouth breathing, then maybe we could get back to the National Office on Woodward Avenue in one piece. We got inside city limits. Earl tipped the hook of his lady at my hand and then offered the knife to me, which I grabbed before Hank could make a pass. Earl was loosening his belt. Shit, now what? "God damn, girl, I have to take a leak," he yelled, like I was squeezing his tank. Chili spoke up, his first words. "We're at 6 Mile, 5 more minutes. Earl took that inspiration to start describing what kind of havoc he and his goop gutter could wreck in the same amount of time. "What's Fleetwood like?" I asked, willing him to leave Saigon. He looked at me like I asked him what it was like on Mars. "Huh? Fleetwood plant," I began again. "Don't you work there with Zelda and Brent and Henry and..." "Work there?" He choked on his spit. "Well, we'll just see, won't we, if I still work there or not." I had no idea what he was talking about. He was still bombing Hanoi. How could someone who glorified his Viet Cong kill count be a contact of a bunch of socialists who, despite our self-defense credo, were more the type to hold hands and sing kumbaya? This guy was a redneck Nazi drug addict. I'd watched my life pass before my eyes for the past 90 minutes, but now I felt something different. Fury. Whoever had let this asshole into our cabbage patch, I might have to take Earl's lady and cut him into a million pieces. The neon sign at Larry's Diner came into view, the coffee shop below our office. Steve P. was gasping, but I kept my eyes on Earl's hands, willing them to move to the right, pull to the curb. Yes, yes, easy, does it. We're here, Hank announced, and leaned all the way over me to put his hand on the steering column and yank out the keys. The car shuddered, and we bumped into another parked vehicle in front of us. Running Horse put his face on Earl's and said over his shoulder, Sue, open his door. Then to him, Earl, you're gonna take a piss now. Shirley climbed out the side panel door, yelling back at Kank, I'll get him, man, I'll get him. How did Earl drive at all? He couldn't walk. He fell down into the street. I heard him, and the thud, and Shirley trying to help him back up. But I was already well down the sidewalk, pushing open the lobby doors and praying the stink would fall behind me. Steve P. was right at my side. When we got to the foyer, he gave me a bear hug. You saved us. I looked at him, shaking my head. No, no, Steve heaved. You're so sweet and nice looking, and you were so kind to that animal. He's a monster. He started weeping, and I had to tug at him to get him to continue climbing the stairs with me. We didn't want to get called back for first aid. Nice to him? I should have throttled him with both hands. You know, you just kept talking to him like you believed in him, which is the only thing he listens to. He's insatiable. He's suicidal, I said, realizing something I knew too well. We should be calling Bellevue. What's Bellevue in Detroit? Steve had his keys out for our next set of doors. Our offices were at one end of the second floor of what had once been a small manufacturing firm. There was nothing at the other end except restrooms. Our new British National Secretary, Hugh Fallon, had tightened up on our security since he'd arrived with his Manchester ingenuity. Now, instead of one set of glass doors and locks, there were two sets of steel doors, each one so heavy that I routinely had to put my shoulder into them to get them open. The first set required one key that you turned twice clockwise. The second door had a deadbolt that went one way and a knob lock that went the opposite. It took me 5 minutes to wrestle through the entrance, but noodle-thin Steve was so quick we spirited through. The second door made a groan when we opened it. Everyone in the office looked up at our grand entrance. Marty Breyer, our 6-foot-tall UMW coal organizer from West Virginia, smiled and said, Allow me, sweetheart, taking my sweaty backpack off my shoulders. Tema told me he used to be an engineer at MIT. I couldn't imagine that. Marty had this way of listening to everyone in a room, like each person's story went right to his heart. Secretary Hugh was in the middle of the room, wearing a lavender shirt with French cuffs, scowling at pallets of new books that had just arrived. Our chief copywriter, Ty Burnside, waved at me without even looking up from his typewriter. And there was Marie again. The camp chef's talk replaced with a striped printer's cap. I could hear Judith, our bookkeeper, who looked like Mona Lisa, talking to the editor's office. Michael, my only Los Angeles comrade in town, sprang up from the back and embraced Steve and me at the same time. I squeezed him back. Don't even tell me what you want now. I'm not going anywhere except a shower. I've just been through a sewer. Michael loosened his hug, acknowledging my stench. I wanted the bathroom key. Steve P. went to get for both of us. But he came back and shook his head. Sorry. He gestured at the doors where Marty had just passed through on his way to the John. Shit! I hate it when a middle-aged person beats you to the bathroom. You have no idea how long it's going to be. What happened? Michael asked. I realized he'd shaved his beard off, the one he'd sported since the day I met him, my first day at Uni High in West LA. Any other day, that would have shocked me, but not today. Steve and I spoke almost simultaneously. Who the fuck is Earl Van Nuys III? Everyone with an earshot looked blank. UAW worker, I continued, someone's contact, supposedly came up to camp from the auto caucus. Steve P. delivered the full picture. This racist, inbred piece of trash almost killed us driving home from camp, and he says he just joined the IS yesterday. Wow, I hadn't heard that part. Ty tried to make light. Oh, now, Steve, don't go talking about inbred to your West Virginia comrades. You have no idea what we've just been through, Steve spat. He may have sounded like a baby, but he was right. I was freezing even though it was June. I wanted a blanket and a hot chocolate. Steve held court about the lady knife and Michael put his hand on my shoulder. Marguerite, the typesetter, came over to me with a purple afghan she always kept on her chair. There was a thud against the outside doors. Not the inner ones, but the thick outer ones, the ones you have to unlock counterclockwise. I wondered if Running Mouth had lost his keys again, but it wasn't his impatient banging. No, it was like a big package someone was shoving against a wall. Oh, Christ. I didn't care. Send in the deliveries, send in the clowns. I wrapped Marguerite's blankie all around me and closed my eyes. So tired. Marty! Hugh yelled, bloody hell! Ty, Michael! Hugh always snapped orders, but I'd never heard him yell like that. I opened my eyes and saw him trying to hold up a much bigger man, failing to push the second door open. Murray and Michael rushed up to help him. The big man collapsed to the floor, and Hugh broke his fall. It was Marty. He'd just gone to the bathroom with the key, but now he was lying on the floor with a huge, dark puddle spreading all over his chest. Hugh struggled out from under Marty's body, his lavender shirt soaked scarlet red. My mind went as blank as stone. A single line entered it, as if in a dialogue balloon. The blood looks just like it does in the movies. Hugh tore off his shirt and pressed it over Marty's chest. It was leaking like a faucet. I could hear Marguerite's voice behind me, summoning an ambulance over the phone, her voice breaking up. But that wasn't the only thing cracking. I heard one, two, three rifles behind me pulling their magazines back. In the seconds since Marty had hit the ground, every man in the office had reached up, down, or behind shelves and desks to appear holding a firearm. Ty Murray, our telephone union guy, Chewy, they all looked at each other like members of a night patrol, like something Earl had told us about. They approached the front doors, anticipating an ambush. I realized they thought we were under siege. Michael, I whispered, and then realized I was whispering. Mikey heard me anyway, and held up his hands to the gun guys. What is it, Sue? Who is it? It's the guy who drove us. It's Earl, I said. He has that special knife. The new battalion doubted me. Chewy claimed there must be more men. He and Ty started taking positions to head down the hall to the bathroom and the front gate. Secure the front doors! Judith screamed. She was Chewy's wife, Hugh's current lover, the only woman there besides Marguerite and me. Hugh excoriated her for calling 911. You fucking idiot! He's dying, Hugh, you bastard! Marty's dying! Hugh stood there, bare-chested in the middle of it all, as if Judith's revelation had brought his own self-interest to heart. I have to get out of here, now, he ordered, and Judith ran up to him, car keys in hand. He turned to Michael. Give me your shirt. I'd love to tell you what happens, but if you want to hear more, write to me at my name, Susie, S-U-S-I-E, at susiebright.com. Good to see you tonight.
Okay, our next reader tonight, what can we say about Lynn Breed Love?
Yeah! Woo!
Lickety s***. He has been at the forefront of so many cool things in San Francisco.
Yeah,
Billboard Liberation Front, Laughing Squid,
Yay.
Burning Man,
Yay.
Cacophony Society,
Yay.
Santa Con,
Woo.
The fucking doggy heads that don't quit, the doggy heads outside.
Everywhere.
He was also raised in Midwest and dreamed about bridges from a very young age. Please welcome John Law.
I'm gonna die up here, but I have AD stuff to go along with. Maybe that'll help a little bit using a gimmick. And my friend Olivier is gonna. This is not. Let's see.
Working.
More. Anyway, I like bridges a lot. I've always liked bridges. I dreamed about them when I was a kid. And I came to San Francisco in 1976, and there are a lot of bridges around here. very fortunate to be in this town. So I eventually, like after 34 years, wrote a book of short stories. It's about 90 pages long. I'm selling them later on. Four trips to the bathroom, you can read it. $12, we'll be at the bar a little later. And these stories are about bridges. They're inspired by my love for bridges. There are three tales in here, one ghost tale, two other stories, and a nonfiction. I'm gonna read from the first story. I'm gonna read about half of it. It's called Lime Point. And some of you may know where Lime Point is. As he awoke, he could hear the foghorns booming. The sound was muffled by the damp shroud that the air had become. It was the dampness that brought him back to consciousness. It had slowly seeped through his bedding, penetrating his shallow and troubled slumber. When he first spread his down bag and insulite pad on the thick middle of the bulkhead, it had been a cool, clear evening just past midnight. No sign of clouds, no wind. He glanced at his watch. In the 2 hours that had passed since then, the night sky had changed dramatically. A plump tendril of fog had stretched out over the amorphous cloud bank that crouched just off the coast. Spurred on by the increasing easterly winds, the fog pushed through the gate and into the bay. By dawn, the process would be complete. Most of San Francisco Bay would be filled, much like a bowl brimming with beaten egg white. Knowing this didn't help with his immediate problem. He was damp and chilled, and his sleeping bag would soon be unusable. Although he had hoped to sleep under the stars, it was becoming apparent that in order to escape the drenching atmosphere, he had no choice but to slip back inside and establish a nest. Taking out the key that he had gone to so much trouble to obtain, he unlocked and opened the heavy metal hatchway and carefully began his descent. He was back inside the top strut of the Golden Gate Bridge. The strut was in itself a small portion of this mammoth structure. It was composed of two parallel trusses with top and bottom cords of heavy girders, skinned all around and riveted plate metal. The resulting chamber was 70 feet long by 20 feet wide and hung suspended between the two Marin tower posts, 700 feet above mean high tide. He came to a stop on a hanging platform midway to the floor of the strut. He switched on his headlamp and began to search out a niche in which he could rest for a while. Bridge painters had hung a staging deck above and to the right of the platform that he was on. It was a fairly heavy plywood deck, supporting piles of tarps and several drums of international orange paint. Brushes, buckets, and miscellaneous painting accoutrements were hanging and lying in piles about the deck. In the farthest corner, he found what he was looking for. The painters had prepared a perfect hidey hole. Overshadowed by the girders was a section of the deck covered in astroturf that was a perfect size for a reclining man. This secret retreat was appointed with a small battery-operated lamp, a deck of cards, several porn magazines, a large thermos jug of water, and a dusty but serviceable cushion. He realized upon closer inspection that his new sanctuary had been designed with care. There was no direct line of sight from any of the interior platforms or walkways, nor could it be seen from the entry hatchway at either the tower post or the one he had just entered from above. It was a perfect place for a painter, iron worker, or perhaps a clandestine bridge climber to nap in safety and solitude with little chance of detection. With several hours until dawn, a bit more sleep would serve him well for the task to come. Using a painter's drop cloth as a dry blanket and his down vest as a pillow, he settled in for some rest. After setting his wristwatch alarm for half an hour before dawn and shutting off his headlamp, he allowed himself the luxury of reflecting on his history with this astonishing structure that he was now reclining in. Since childhood, he was consumed by an impractical yet overwhelming love for and interest in bridges. This interest was one of the elements that had propelled him into a career as a photojournalist. First time he had climbed the Golden Gate Bridge some 2 years before, he was convinced, up until the actual moment he set foot on the box girders below the road deck, that it would not be possible to ascend. Getting out along the beams below the road deck was one thing, but finding a way into the tower posts, those elegant duo pillars that soared taller than any other bridge in the country, well, that would be a trip. He had considered walking the cables with a security camera hanging below the lowest horizontal strut. The one just above the roadway seemed to have the cables well within its viewing scope. It was obvious that to attempt the cables could only be a last resort. Approaching from beneath the roadway seemed best. That first climb stayed with him as only the rarest of dream images will. He recalled each part in dark pastel detail. Subsequent climbs, though always rewarding, were never as spectrally impressed onto his mind's eye. The approach he used was from the cliffs above Lime Point. A trail plunged down and zigzagged crazily along the crest of the cliff face, descending eventually to a 10 or 12 foot leap under the broad man-made plateau directly below the road deck. He jumped down the last few feet from the trail to the plateau. Standing at the very edge, he could look across a foreboding gulf of over 100 yards distance, yawning open and deadly before the mammoth cross girders of the Marin Tower. A quick toss of his short climbing rope up and over the girder about 15 feet overhead, followed by a short climb, placed him on the lower cord of the road deck, 20 feet below the pedestrian walkway. Once on the superstructure, he reminded himself that in the dark, on a structured climb, every plane, every space, every angle were all simply different shades of gray. You could easily step into the air thinking you're stepping onto a gusset plate or an I-beam. One could not depend solely on vision. He advanced, sometimes walking, sometimes crawling along the girders. Several yards along, the plateau beneath him fell away to the full drop of over 200 feet to the rocky shoreline and the lighthouse below. Every 40 feet or so, the girder he was traversing intersected a vertical compression girder. At these junctures, he had to climb out and around the beams, hanging momentarily in quiet, empty space, just 2 seconds above eternity. Having made his way to the relative safety of a catwalk, which skirted the colossal tower post just below the pedestrian walkway, he was able to relax and breathe in the unreal brilliance of the singular panorama he found himself in the midst of. His aerie was a perfect viewing spot. The massive roadway decking supported by the elaborate latticework of the girders shot out above him back towards the cliff face he had so recently vacated. The resemblance it bore to a gigantic erector set was unmistakable. The view under this ponderous firmament down to the rocks and surf and then back toward the plateau was so akin to a towering Panavision movie image that he could hardly accept it as real. For some reason, it reminded him of the last scenes of the film North by Northwest. In particular, he referred back to the dreamlike image of Cary Grant and Eva Marie Saint clinging desperately to the sheer granite wall separating the colossal visages of Washington and his proteges as Martin Landau loomed grimly above them. In his mind's eye, the colossal image of the actual cliff seemed indistinguishable from the fantasy image of the film. Enhancing this reverie, the sounds of the surf below conjoined with the sharper, more distant murmur of the late night traffic to form a sound mosaic that embraced him in a strange synesthesia. Realizing the need to regain clarity of mind for the remainder of his precarious climbing adventure, he reluctantly tore his attention away from this entrancing phantasm. He pressed his attention toward the comparatively prosaic task of finding a hatchway that would allow ingress to the tower. To his great surprise, he did not need to search for long. Contrary to his assumption that the tower would be locked up tight, several entry hatches had been carelessly left open by bridge workers. As he entered the closest hatchway, he was aware of subtle shifts in his sensory perceptions. The ever-present sound of waves crashing against Line Point 200 feet below him could almost be felt pressing against his skin as the darkness of the shaft engulfed him. He began climbing the rungs, passing through the hatchway portals every 20 feet or so. For some daring or perhaps perverse reason, he chose to ascend in darkness. At first, the climb in complete blackness was invigorating. Gradually, his excitement at the novelty of his situation turned to a sort of grim resolve to continue. He kept climbing, sightlessly, refusing to use his light, despite his increasing unease caused by the bizarre tactile hallucinations he seemed to be experiencing. What should have been metal all around him began to feel less and less substantial. His hands, holding him away from what he knew to be riveted plate metal, seemed to almost vibrate in unison with what felt like pliant, fleshy matter. The atmosphere was dense and wet. It seemed as though he was underwater. The shaft he was in, a 3-foot square cell that shot up the entire height of the tower, should have been metal. It was not. Fumbling with his light, he could feel the cloying atmosphere closing in around him. That droning murmur, was it the water below? It almost sounded like voices. The shaft seemed smaller and yet smaller. Losing some nerve, he reached for his light. It would not work. Frustrated, he smashed it against a riveted wall. The anticipated crash did not occur. Instead, the impact was a sodden thud, splattering him with some unknown liquid. Stopping the hatchway, he knew that he should have been standing on a floor plate with a man-sized round hole for ladder access. The floor did not feel hard. He felt for the ladder rungs that he knew should be there. Grasping a rung, he pulled himself up a step. It almost seemed that his shoes would be sucked off of his feet. His dead flashlight fell from his grasp. It made no noise as it fell. Dampness further embraced him. There was an increasing pressure around his ankles. He scrambled for the next rung, panic welling up in his throat, the taste of it like ashes. If he could only reach the next hatch hole, he pulled as hard as he could, yet the pressure on his ankles only increased. It felt like huge, soft hands wrapped entirely around his lower legs, holding even tighter to the rungs above. He pulled and pulled. One leg wrenched free, apparently ripping loose a pulpy clot of what could have been flesh from the homunculus that was restraining him. His terror was now a palpable thing. He felt a flash of brilliant light from below. It seemed to pass through him. Turning his gaze to that which clutched him, he felt an intense pressure on a point in the center of his forehead. As his eyes swept downward, the pressure increased proportionately to the brilliance of the light below. The rotting hands clutching at his lower body inexorably increased their grip. He screamed, the light blinded him. The point on his forehead burned, spreading his eyes, his cheeks. He screamed again. He sat bolt upright and flailed out madly, knocking buckets and brushes all about. Waking from his evil dream was like bursting to the surface of a viscous lake of human effluent. His forehead, indeed his whole face, was wet. He mopped his brow with his sleeve, realizing that, fortunately, he was merely drenched in sweat. His earlier pleasant reminiscences had slipped into a dream state and then into something else. He shook himself and tried to recall what specters had been so horrific that they had caused him to awake screaming. That's the first half of the story. If you want to read the rest, talk to me at the bar later. Thank you very much.
John Law, everybody. And the Bridges. I can't believe people climb bridges. That just freaks me out. I can't do it. Okay, our final author, and after this, there's a whole other hour of the lit crawl continuing down the mission, so be sure to skedaddle on down the road and see some other stuff that's going on tonight. There's only 68 venues in 3 hours, over 300 authors. It's stupid, really. I don't know why it's so big. People just wanted to do it. Okay, our final reader tonight. What do you say? Circus Ridiculous. Porn Karaoke. Yeah. Ask Dr. Hal. Yeah. Damn it, the Wonder Dog. Yeah. Crazy fucked up performance space down at the Army. Cesar Chavez. He is an insultant, confusionist, mechanic, writer, activist, lover, hater, showman, and he is the author of a book that was published this year, and it costs like $40,000 a copy, right?
No.
Something like that. Anyway, it's titled Fail to Win, Engineered Disperfection Explained. And also, he ran for mayor of San Francisco. Please welcome Chicken John!
Chapter that I had to edit down so I can fit it into the 8 minutes. and stuff, although I would have gladly given my 8 minutes to Lynn Breedlove. What would you have thought of that bat? She's the best. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and read this to you, I think. I need light for this. Wow, really? How'd you guys do it? More glass. Oh, here we go. Okay. This chapter is called Jesus Loves You. And here we go. Collect call from a correctional facility. Will you accept the charges? You would have expected that whatever comes after this is going to be bad news, but I was delighted. The gravelly voice on the other end of the phone had a Boston accent and a nasal tone. It belonged to Gigi Allen. He was getting out of prison in 2 months and wanted to put a band together and tour. Gigi Allen and the Murder Junkies. He'd heard I played like Johnny Thunders, and I had a van. I was 23. Trying to explain Gigi is impossible. He was a singer with an odd charisma, covered, hands down, in the worst tattoos you've ever seen, and some pretty alarming scars. I liked to play my guitar, but not in the time of the sissy wannabe crap that was prevalent at that time. I wanted to rock for real, loud, fast. Rock and roll was stuck in some limp dick commercial poison marketing module. I wanted to do something real. I wanted to play in a band that when you saw us live, it could change your life. So I joined the Murder Junkies. Gigi was the patron saint of punk rock. There was no fiction in his show. There were no airs to put on. He had what everyone wanted, a rock and roll show that wasn't just show. He was having an adventure in being a human being, and there was no acting or smoke or mirrors. You go to the show, and you could die. The world could change. I'm going to try to tell you what happened, and it's all true, but you still might not believe me. There was fucking blood everywhere, and shit. In the beginning, let's say it's 1984 or so, Gigi traveled around with a tape. The tape was his backup band. He would give the tape to the sound man and sing over it. Even later, when he had a band, he'd still give the tape to the sound man, secretly, in case the band decided to flee. Gigi would sing along with the recording and attack the audience. Physically attack them, punch them, kick them, wearing only a jock strap. He would beat his head and face in with the live mic. And people would cringe. He would smear blood all over himself. A half hour before going on, he'd eat a box of X-Lax. Liquid shit everywhere, throwing it, eating it, smearing it, and hitting anyone who came near. Possessed, like a madman, in front of like 20 people. In tiny, tiny clubs, in cafes, anywhere that would book him, places he's never been before. He would take the Greyhound bus to get there and had no way out, nowhere to stay. He would grab his bag, his face a bloody mess, and split, covered in shit, sleep on the ground, like a dog. Why? Why would someone do this? To be interesting? I don't think so. So many avant-garde gestures get done and overdone to death after they're established, but Gigi forged a path that anyone could follow, and no one has. That's significant. For me, it seemed like he was eliminating consequences. He was getting unstuck, devolving, prioritizing, although he might have never looked into it that far. And it was to be admired, truly. Not like the admiration you have for great writers or for people who quit smoking. This is different. Gigi figured out that there really wasn't anything that anyone was going to do to stop him. I mean, he brought it down to a guttural level. Remember, at that time, rock and roll was Night Ranger, Bon Jovi. Even the punk rock of that time was kind of safe. A trend in hardcore called straight edge, where the practitioners abstained from sex, booze, drugs, and violence. Soon, hardcore free thinkers were becoming Hare Krishnas. It was a small step. But rock and roll was becoming sterile. Comparatively, Gigi took a literal stance. It was severe, severe comedy. He was talking, he was taking all the demons from his childhood and facing them. Empowerment. He was working it out, tabula rasa, right there at the show in some kind of self-made ritual. I mean, usually when you go to see a show, there's no contact with the band. It's a spectator sport, which is why I instantly recognized what Gigi was doing was more shamanistic. Now stay with me. His blood, your blood, my blood, it was unlike anything else you've ever experienced. In this game, the stopping point is a different spot than the rest of life. He was going to violate your human rights. Why? Why? fight your human rights to wake you up. He was doing what he did because he hated what the world had become, and he didn't want to have anything to do with it. He just wasn't going to knuckle under. He liked to rock, and with the mic in his hand and a band behind him and the madness of the moment was his only master. He was free, like the Buddha, only uglier and with bad tattoos. He redefined what it meant to rock. All these dippy, long-haired rockers in cowboy boots like some gypsy fashion show. If one of them ever got a hangnail, they'd cancel a tour. But Gigi was going to finish this set no matter how much blood he lost. He was going to throw his shit into the crowd and watch them all rush the exit in a stampede. It wasn't good, it wasn't fun, but it was shamanistic. He was putting this raw experience right in front of you. He could conjure it, and you couldn't. Liquid shit everywhere. Chairs, tables, flying through the air. Naked, ugly, drums used as weapons. People screaming. Drinks were spilled and then drank. Piss, puke, tears, liability. Gigi was gonna push and push. The safest place to be in the room was on stage next to him. So that's where I hung out. Playing guitar in the Murder Junkies was fucking awesome. Most shows lasted less than a minute, which was frustrating. But when it worked like nothing else. Gigi was, in fact, willing to die to get his point across. And no matter how serious and dire it may all sound to you now, it was quite mirthful. Sure, we had to pick broken glass out of his wounds by the headlights of the van sometime. And the insane drummer masturbated while sitting next to you in the van while you were asleep, which was unkind. Ironically, I was in monastic training the whole time this was going on. So it goes. So what happened? This is a fascinating question. Public animal number one got famous, rich and famous. Baffling. He didn't see it coming, and none of us did. Once he was famous, the guy who was willing to die for rock and roll got, well, he got confused. Somehow his kryptonite was love. Admiration made a slight adjustment and became adoration. And no one ran for the exit anymore. People were pushing to the front to be the next person smacked in the head. He was signing autographs. It was kind of hysterical. Watching his reaction was priceless. Gigi was just stumped. Oh, punch me, Gigi, punch me next. The whole row of people at the front were screaming, and he just didn't know what to do. Confronted with a failure that he did not engineer, he did exactly what the winners he so loudly despised had done before him. And at the end, he was selling paintings of John Wayne Gacy for $10,000. He turned to control, and he took himself very, very seriously. And I had box seats to that show, the real show, which was Gigi trying to keep up with the plot twist that was holding the surprise ending to the screenplay of his life. And it was amusing, but also sad. I say this now with great trepidation, as the situation couldn't possibly be more complex. But he sold out. Not in a standard way. He didn't have that luxury. He was so confused, so deluded, he either wasn't smart enough, savvy enough, or the options available to him were not diverse enough for him to do anything else, and he caved. He retreated to some messiah complex that I didn't buy at all. Nobody did. The Gigi that I knew and loved did what he did for pussy, for punk rock, and for the party! So it was confusing when he started ranting about some higher power crap, talking about his followers like they were some cult. Sure, they may have talked crazy, but like a pointed, politically peppered terrorist act? I don't think so. He tried to write songs about his murder mission and went on Jerry Springer talking about recruits. It's real, it's totally real. He lost his message, and I refused to participate. I was vocal in saying that I thought that his newfound ego was some macho power trip, and that resulted in me being hard to work with. Can you imagine the guy who's rolling around in broken glass and shit telling me I'm not a team player? And at the end, Todd Phillips made a student film for his graduate thesis at NYU Film School, a documentary on Gigi Allen. It won all the awards in 1992. It's called Hated. How many people have seen Hated? You guys are missing out. You can rent it at last weekend. Todd Phillips became the real big winner out of all of us. His last movie, The Hangover, is the highest grossing comedy of all time. How the fuck did that happen?
No way.
Gigi's last gig in New York City was at the gas station. After the show, he led a mob of screaming punk rock freaks to my last apartment, chanting, "Chicken John's a coward!" looking to kill me. Unfortunately, I was at the Oregon Country Fair. Blessed be. He died a few hours later. He died of a heroin overdose on Johnny Puig's floor on June 28th, 1993. They replaced Gigi with another singer when he died. The Murder Junkies are still a band. I can't even imagine. I guess, what else are those guys gonna do? I shouldn't judge. But to just get another Gigi? There's truly nothing sacred. I know there is a financial motivation, and it puts a chill in the air to imagine that Gigi was just another pebble on life's rocky road. 2 years before that, sitting around a table at a club in Boston or somewhere, hanging out with a couple local girls, drinking 8-ounce beers and chatting, Gigi said the funniest thing I've ever heard in my entire life, and I will share it with you now. One of the girls was yammering on and on about how her father was suppressive and controlling. "He doesn't let me date, and I can't stay out past 10 o'clock, yada, yada, yada." She was complaining about her lot in life, and Gigi seemed to be genuinely concerned. She says to Gigi, in particular, "Do you think that I'm not going to be a well-adjusted adult with my dad being so overprotective?" And Gigi responded, "Well, I had a pretty bad childhood, and I turned out okay." Okay, indeed. Rest in peace, gypsy motherfucker. That's my time. I just want to say before I leave the stage.
What about the whipped cream?
I appreciate that you will let the consequence stay on the stage and not on me. I think that means I did a good job. Thanks for listening.
Insist for this label, imitation. Buy from reputable dealers.